Hello there. Today we are going to discuss what are the various dynamical processes that go on when the resonance takes place. We will first discuss in general for any resonance absorption and then in particularly the differences that we need to keep in mind for EPR transition. For simplicity, again let us consider only two level system, higher level and lower level, lower level and upper level, let us say we call it. And let us say we have got a collection of particles which are distributed in these two levels according to Boltzmann distribution, number of particle in upper level by number of particle in the lower level is given by where T is the temperature of system and this is delta E. Now, if some radiation falls here which is matching with this energy gap and the selection rules are satisfied, then what can happen? Of course, then of course it can absorb radiation and this particle which are lying here can go from here to there. Okay, that is the absorption process. This is absorption, let us call it absorption process. But there are some particles which are here, they can also undergo transition from here to there because of this radiation. Why is that? Because the selection rule we have seen earlier, let us say from upper to lower in the presence of some perturbation. This gives the probability of transition from let us say lower to upper or upper to lower, the form is the same. So, probability of transition is actually the same thing whether it starts from here goes there or it starts from here or goes here, that is the perturbation due to the radiation. So, we call that induced emission or stimulated emission. Along with that, the particles which are in the excited state can come to ground state by its own natural process, let us call it some natural process. What are the natural processes? In optical experiment, for example, EV visible experiment, the natural processes are fluorescence emission, phosphorescence emission. Those are radiative processes by means of which the particle in the excited state can come to ground state. Now, these three things can happen in general in all experiment that involves transition in the presence of radiation. Now, this fluorescence or phosphorescence, these are spontaneous processes. These processes can be actually they are nothing but the spontaneous process. Why we call spontaneous? Because this takes place even in the absence of any such external perturbation. Now, in the experiment that involves magnetic resonance like NMR and EPR, in principle this will of course take place, this can in principle take place, but there is a catch. The catch is that the probability of this spontaneous process that drastically goes down when the wavelength of this experiment or the energy gap between the two becomes very small. Where does that come from? It comes from Einstein's we call A and B coefficient. This gives the probability of spontaneous emission by the probability of induced emission is given by A by B, which is this is the expression. So, you see the spontaneous emission and the induced emission, these two ratio are given by the frequency. This frequency is related to the energy gap here. And not only that, this depends on the cube of the frequency. So, as the energy gap becomes smaller and smaller, this spontaneous emission probability becomes smaller and smaller very quickly. So, whereas in optical experiment where fluorescence and phosphorescence becomes very common process for excited molecule to come to ground state, when it comes to magnetic resonance experiments, NMR or EPR, this is so small that spontaneous emission probability virtually goes to zero. So, no spontaneous emission in the microwave frequency. So, in these three processes that we have here, one is out. So, what we have now, this is the lower level, this is the upper level. So, in the presence of radiation, I have absorption process and this is the induced emission or stimulated emission, if you like to call it stimulated emission, and this is not present. What can happen now? Let us try to imagine. To start with, before the radiation was applied, the number of particles in the lower and upper level followed this Boltzmann distribution. So, the number of particles here, let us call it now n lower and n upper. So, if there was no radiation here present, then n upper by n lower will be equal to delta E by kT, and that is the Boltzmann distribution. And let us put a superscript 0 here to indicate that is what happens when nothing else is disturbing the system. In thermal equilibrium, these are the proportion distribution, and total number of particles is equal to n 0 alpha plus n 0 upper and n 0 lower. Now, the rate of transition in the presence of radiation will depend on the probability times the number of particles which are present here for going up. Similarly, for this process, the rate of stimulated emission will depend on the number of particles which are here and the probability of this. So, I will have the let us say W downward and W upward. These are the transition probability in the absence of this radiation. That is important, that this polarization distribution maintain all the time. So, if there are some transition which are taking place on its own, which are not induced by this one and which is maintaining this distribution, then what we must conclude from here is that rate of this downward transition, that is the probability of going down times the number of particles in thermal equilibrium here, which is n 0 upper, must be equal to rate of upward transition in the number of particles in the lower level. Once again, these rates are the not the rate, this is the probability for transition in the absence of any external perturbation. Then naturally, if some transition taking place which is maintaining the thermal equilibrium and maintaining the population distribution according to the Boltzmann law. So, in that case, this must be satisfied. This is same as saying that this is satisfied automatically. Okay. Now, if there is some disturbance to the population distribution, then let us say that time n u and n l are the new number of particles here which are different from the thermal equilibrium values here. Then n alpha plus n le n of will also be equal to n, the number of particles remain the same. I may have come to an assertion that these are taking place here all the time, even if there is no perturbation, that may sound a little bit far-fetched and ad hoc. Why do I need that? So, to appreciate that, let us once again go back to this situation where nothing else happens, that is, this has been removed and these two processes are taking place there. Then what can happen is that radiation will try to push this molecule from here to there and also push molecule from here to here. Now, though in the beginning there are many particles, slightly more number of particles here than there, initially the rate of upward transition will be more than rate of downward transition. So, if nothing else is happening, then what happens? Very soon these two levels will get equally populated. So, that means we will not see any net absorption of radiation. So, these two processes are taking place and then these two levels become equally populated. So, no net absorption of radiation. So, no absorption spectrum. So, that is the problem, that if there are no other processes involved here, then very soon the moment the light is shown and resonance count is satisfied, the absorption will disappear, two levels will get equally populated. That is the key problem, that how can we see a net absorptive signal if these are the only two processes. So, there must be some other process which maintains some sort of population difference here, which can be sustained even in the presence of radiation. And this population difference is the one which decides the amount of light that is absorbed, and that gives the absorption spectrum. So, you see that is the requirement we have to fulfill, so that we can explain that we see the absorption spectrum in the spectrometer. Because we see the absorption in the spectrometer, we have to incorporate a process other than these two, and that we call relaxation process. Now, this relaxation process is not same as the spontaneous emission process of the kind that we have normally seen in optical experiment. It is something other than that. So, this is the probability of downward transition and upward transition because of this natural relaxation processes. And that is present all the time, and that maintains the thermal equilibrium. So, this is the relationship we get. Now, if this population changes, what way the system will try to develop a new steady state condition so that net absorption of radiation can be seen. Okay. So, the absorption of radiation of course proportional to n alpha a minus n this difference. This is the population difference. See, if population difference is 0, then there is no absorption of radiation. Okay. So, in thermal equilibrium, these are the number of particles in upper and lower level. So, let us say n 0 in thermal equilibrium can be written as n 0 L minus n 0 upper level. So, as much as here I have n 0 L plus n 0 E is also equal to n, the number of particles remain the same. Now, when the transition takes place, this population difference, I can say n new population difference n alpha minus n L minus n U. When one particle, let us say, makes transition from here to there, then the population difference changes by 2 units, because one comes from here to there, the difference becomes 2. So, dn by dt can be written as probability of this going downward transition times the number of particles in upper level lower level. We are still considering the situation that how does this relaxation process maintain this population difference. We have not yet applied the radiation yet. So, only the difference is that if the population difference has become different from the equilibrium value, and that is NL NU, how this relaxation process try to bring back the population difference to the equilibrium value. So, this is the probability for downward transition from here to here. So, the number of particles which are here, similarly the upward transition, a factor of 2 is because each transition changes the population difference by 2 unit. Okay, using these equations, one can write that this is, by the way, thermal equilibrium condition. From this relation, this, you can write this is in terms of the population difference n and the total number of particles. If we substitute this here, we get this value. Now, this could be simplified as this is the total number of particles and this is the population difference at a given instant. Now, if we define that average of the upward probability and downward probability is W, then I get dN by dt is minus N. All right. Now, let us see here we use this condition which relates the upward rate in terms of N0L and N0U and downward rate in the process. We can change this equation to look like this. From here, we write dN by dt. You expand this, and this will give W n. Now, here, now see that this is actually equal to this, this is equal to this here, this is the thermal equilibrium condition. So, we might as well cancel that, but instead let us do a little bit of mathematical trick. So, you could as well write this equal to so this gives me W down plus W up N0L minus N0U. So here using the same average value of the probability, I can write this is 2W N0L minus N0U. Of course, this term is there 2WN, so minus 2WN. So, this is therefore equal to, now this is nothing but the population difference in thermal equilibrium. So, we call it N0. So, this is 2W N0 minus N. So, this is the expression for the rate of change of population difference in terms of the average transition probability due to the internal relaxation processes written in this fashion. So, this shows that any deviation of the population difference from the equilibrium value can give rise to non-zero value of this one. Or in other words, when this is same as equilibrium value, this is 0, which is understandable. When system has already reached thermal equilibrium, there is no more change in the population difference. Okay, but anyhow, let us see how it looks like if n is different from n 0, then this integration can be carried out very easily. N 0 minus n at time t equal to t is equal to given as n 0 minus n at time t equal to 0 into exponential 2 w t. So, what is the significance of the equation? At t equal to 0, this is the population difference, the deviation of the population difference from the thermal equilibrium value. As t goes to very large value infinity, then this goes to 0. So, n 0 minus n goes to 0, or n tends to n 0. So, that is what the relaxation process is trying to do. Any non-Boltzmann distribution that gives rise to this n, which is different from the equilibrium value of n 0, will be brought in to this value if we allow sufficient time to pass, and these are brought about by whatever the internal relaxation processes which are working all the time. So, now we can understand that why it is important that these are present there, so that we can see the absorption spectrum. As I said earlier, if these were absent, then these two processes will make these two levels equally populated and we cannot see any net absorption signal. So, these are the most important requirement for observing the steady state spectrum, which are we are seeing in the EPR experiment or in NMR experiment. Relaxation processes are very important. Now, this shows that relaxation process also, this rate of change of this restoration of the population deviation from the thermal equilibrium is a exponential process. So, we can give a time constant to it. So, if we write it as say 2 w is equal to 1 by t 1, then this could be written as n 0 minus n t exponential minus t over t 1. So, this is the sort of characteristic time constant which decides or which brings back the thermal equilibrium if the equilibrium is disturbed by whatever means. Now, how do we visualize this relaxation processes? We can think of now in particular an EPR experiment, that we have got there is a collection of spins, maybe I have got a number of spins which are put in a magnetic field, and we have restored this equilibrium is satisfied, the Boltzmann distribution. In case of alpha by n beta, this is the Boltzmann distribution. So, all the spins are not pointing in the same direction, some of them will be parallel to the magnetic field, some will be in the opposite direction. So, effectively therefore, the total sample acquires certain magnetization. A magnetization I call M, which is the average of all these. If we take over all the particles there, then this magnetization has a certain value because these two levels are not equally populated. Now, suppose I suddenly switch off the magnetic field, then this magnetization has to disappear, the all spins will get randomly oriented, and that takes certain time. So, that time is the time that we say here the system is trying to go from certain orientation to random distribution. So, we can call this is the relaxation time for this magnetization to get destroyed, and this will follow exponential time difference of this kind. We can do the reverse experiment. So the spins are present, Avogadro number of spins are present, and there is no magnetic field. So there is no particular direction of quantization. So number of alpha spins are equal to number of beta spins. There is no net magnetization. Now suddenly suppose I switch on the magnetic field, then they are going to reach this distribution and magnetization is going to develop. So how much time it takes to bring up that magnetization? That process also is going to happen in this fashion in an exponential manner. The time taken or characteristic time for such process is called the relaxation time for this restoration of the magnetization. Now here you see that for this two level system, whenever the transition has to take place from here to there, it involves absorption of radiation. But this relaxation process tries to maintain the equilibrium, so it always try to adjust its population such a way that the thermal equilibrium is restored. So in particular, if there are more particles here than here, then when this has to reach thermal distribution, some amount of energy has to be given out from this spin system to the surrounding. So this process therefore, which restores the equilibrium distribution between the two level, we call that spin lattice relaxation process. Now here lattice is a very generic term. It implies that for redistribution of particles, there is an involvement of energy exchange between spin system and the surrounding, and the process which does that we call the spin lattice relaxation process. And because it involves exchange of energy with the surrounding is given a very generic term as the lattice. Surrounding is called the lattice, so not necessarily a crystal lattice. In fact, the surrounding need not necessarily be the solvent, it could be different degrees of freedom of the molecule itself. Okay, so this is given a characteristic time, that T1 I have given here, and you see that this W is average of the probability of upward transition and the downward transition. Each of them involves exchange of energy. Average value of that is one called 2 times average value of this is 1 by T1. So the more efficient the relaxation process, shorter will be the T1. There is another kind of relaxation process involved in magnetic resonance. To understand that, again we go back to this idea of net magnetization. In thermal equilibrium, the spins point either along the direction of the magnetic field or the opposite direction to generate a net magnetization along the direction of the magnetic field. The direction of magnetic field is z direction, then at thermal equilibrium this magnetization has let us say mx my mz, this sort of these three components there. But at thermal equilibrium there is no x component and no y component, only z component is present there. Now suppose there is some disturbance to the spin system and net mx and my component are created, then what happens? Again there will be relaxation process which will try to restore this mx not equal to 0 to this state. Similarly, my which is not equal to 0, will try to bring it to this state, because these are again non-Boltzmann distribution, non-thermal equilibrium. To restore thermal equilibrium, this mx my component of the net magnetization must go to 0. That also involves not the energy exchange with the surrounding, but the spin system must rearrange themselves in such a way that all the mx and my component goes to 0. That is also a relaxation process. We call that spin relaxation.
And it's usually it is written by
given a time constant, written in terms of designated as T2. Now, finally, we just examine what role it plays in deciding the signal of an absorption spectrum.
Qualitatively, what we are observing here are the result of three processes. This is the beta, this is alpha, and radiation comes in. So, this causes this absorption, stimulated emission, and the relaxation, which is trying to maintain the propulsion difference. So, this is the relaxation process. So, this is stimulated emission, this is the absorption. So, if this rate becomes very strong or very efficient compared to this one, then these two population difference becomes smaller and smaller, that this process is not efficient enough to restore the thermal distribution. So, the population difference will go down and effectively signal will also go down. So, in magnetic resonance, this efficiency of these two processes can be decided by this transition alpha, perturbation beta. This we have seen earlier lecture, that this is nothing but B1 field that is present there in the xy plane, and square of that gives rise to the probability of this sort of transition there. So, here this is related to the microwave magnetic field that is used to observe the EPR signal, and so square of that V1 square is proportional to power of the microwave frequency. So, if the power becomes high, this becomes more and more efficient, and this may not be able to cope up with the stimulated absorption emission process. So, the signal will become smaller and smaller, because these two level becomes more and more equally populated. So, one has to be careful in deciding how much microwave power to use to observe the EPR signal. For those systems where the relaxation is very efficient, this will not be of much serious concern, but for some systems when it is relaxation is not very efficient, this could be a potential problem. So, you see here, therefore, the relaxation process, which are always present there, plays a fundamentally important role in allowing us to see the EPR signal, and without that we may not be able to see the spectrum at all if the relaxation is very inefficient. With this, we come to the end of this lecture.